Public Works Farm Subcommittee meeting. I apologize, I have a lot of work happening. The administrator's gone down below to bring us up-to-date information, income and expenses for that department. I'd just like to say that Commissioner Schmidt, Representative Schmidt had some surgery a couple weeks back, and his mobility is not up to par at this point in time. And he's not able to attend meetings for a little while, and hopefully his recovery will come along fine. In his absence, I asked Madam Chairman whether she would consider reappointing or sitting in his absence, because he's uncertain how long he's going to be away. I wanted to have a meeting, if I have, with the other departments to come up to speed ahead of our next meeting. And Karen was kind enough to say that she would sit in his stay. So Karen's sitting here in official capacity. So yes.
Is there an agenda for today's meeting?
It's a work session, pretty free form. If you have something else you'd like to add as we go along, please do.
I wanted to understand better what the purpose was. So usually we update during the budget process. I was just curious about why we were doing it now.
Thank you, Representative. I have been noticing the projections for income are falling behind. I've asked a few questions on that. The commissioners have been looking at a request that we'd asked before about going out to bid through the nursing home subcommittee for the care of grounds winter and summer. Thought we'd just touch on some of those items today. So with that, I had asked back in August some questions to Will that were related back through the superintendent on revenues. And Will, if you wouldn't mind, you want to just come sit somewhere at the table and we'll go through this?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for taking time. The question I've posed a couple times, and I'm really not clear yet. We were in past times, we shift the direction from cordwood sales to firewood sales, being a better revenue producer. And it was my understanding when we started this year that we were no longer doing cordwood and that we were just doing that. That we had contracts in excess of what we had the year before. And when I keep looking at numbers, and I just don't know if the state hasn't paid to date their monies, but if you could help me out and explain to me how that process works. Do we physically have contracts with them to produce wood for that purpose?
No, we don't physically have contracts. We just have a general commitment with the retail manager down at the state that is the retail manager for all the park states. State parks.
State parks.
And that is that they're looking for X number of bags of wood at a certain price. Is that what it is?
Correct.
And Do we get assurance as one of those suppliers that we're going to produce a certain amount, or we get that much of that job, or how's that work?
Well, currently I've never been able to produce more. Farm has never been able to produce more than what they will take. So as much as we can produce, they'll take. And we've never produced more than what they take. Sales are completely out the door with them.
Okay, so whatever you can produce, they take.
Correct.
And are they, did they pay what you thought they were gonna pay this year when you started production?
Yes, it was the same, when we started production, it was the same price, and we do a fuel surcharge depending on the location of, you know, how far we have to go. Each of the campgrounds is a different mileage. Then also this year, I've, at the end of the season, to kind of bring you up to speed,
please,
is we ran short on logs. So I've been raising a concern over the last several years that we're selling more and we don't have the inventory. So what's happened is we got to this year and we did not have enough logs to have seasoned wood for them. They like to take seasoned campfire wood so that campers can burn it. So we ran out, basically, at the beginning of July. We were sold out of all the wood we had to be able to go to them. So going forward, now we've got wood in, we've got the season this summer, we're bagging as we speak, and I renegotiated the price. We're gonna be getting an extra 50 cents a bag on the hardwood, and we're also getting into the softwood market for them, because the softwood market right now is, there's not much of a market, so it's easier to get logs in. Hardwood market is very strong, so it's hard for us to get fine hardwood logs. So I negotiated with them to get into the softwood program. So we'll do the bags, also the same bags, will be color coded for hardwood and softwood, and we'll take some softwood at a reduced price. It'll be 50 cents less a bag than the hardwood.
May I?
Please.
Yeah. For campfires, really, it doesn't matter what kind of wood it is, right?
I think that's probably personal choice and personal opinion, to be honest with you. I mean, some people, I personally don't care either, but some people prefer to have the hardwood versus the softwood, and the state in the past has asked for all hardwood, so that's why that's what we've provided. So I don't really know how to answer your question other than my opinion. I'm fine with it, but.
I mean, it's.
If you use softwood, though, I mean, you really have to make sure it's dry. And if you use pine, you get that snap, crackle, pop that most campfires, that, you know, that most campers like to have.
What do I know?
Yeah.
So, just for the general discussion, it burns at a different rate, so it depends if it matters to you whether or not your fire is quick and hot or long and slow.
That's a good analogy.
Yeah, I'm aware of
the. Let's, okay, so yeah. If I just go back a little. So, your directive from the state on firewood says it has to be hardwood. Did they have a pricing if it wasn't hardwood that it could also be softwood?
Right, that's what, in the past we've always done all hardwood to them, that's what they've always wanted. This year, I've asked if we could introduce pine, because we can get pine pulp in at a more reasonable rate and more availability. And he agreed that next year that we could introduce some pine into it.
Okay. Is it possible for you to provide that directive to us as to what the state's looking for?
Okay. What? I told you. What are you looking? You want me to write you?
No. He wants it in writing from the state.
You want it in writing? Okay. I've never had anything in writing from the state. So you want me to get it from them that we can do pine now?
Yeah. They must have something. They post on their website. How do they go out and get contracts for what?
Or the guy you normally deal with, just have him send you an email saying this.
It shouldn't be that difficult. So in July you ran out of wood.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now if I go back to when we purchased the. Wood splitter, wood processor. We had a directive, memorandum, whatever, from the delegation that said we were in favor of buying the wood splitter and that we were going to not be buying log length wood anymore after that, because we were going to produce our own wood from the farm, from the our own properties. And I've been reminded continuously that we haven't followed that directive or our first, when was our first cut again after we purchased it? I know there was an issue of whether the hardwood was more valuable and some of it was sold off. How many years ago was that? And if you don't remember, but just go ahead and say it.
I think it was, and sometime in 2014 is when we had it. We purchased it in the summer of 2013, the wood processor. We had the next cut sometime in 2014.
And we have a cut that's coming up in 2016?
Yes.
So, and then how much log length did we buy? I know we authorized some log length to be bought last year for production.
And you're talking 2014?
Yes, 415. Didn't we buy wood in 2014 for 15?
Very little because we came off that log cut. Well, because I am pretty much selling everything that I'm given, so I'm selling close to 200 cords of wood between both programs, and I'm only being given enough money to buy like 150 cords, so I'm selling more than what's coming in, and that's why we've had to go, the property can't produce as much as what I've been selling, and that's the problem.
Well, I guess my question is, what are our two programs? Because as under the full impression, the only program we're using was firewood.
Well, we did campfire wood, and then this year we took a reduction in amount of cordwood. But those orders, it came in back in March, and so we still filled those orders. So we did about 30 cords of cordwood this year, versus last year we did about 80. So we have reduced it down to the campfire wood to mostly be doing the campfire wood program.
But what I keep coming back to is that the impression we had stopped doing cordwood, and I sat here.
Except the ones that...
Well, I don't remember that exception being added onto it. We sat here, and I believe you said to me that, Representative, after all these years, I've come to realize that we're probably better off, cost-effective, to be doing firewood production only, and we're not doing cordwood anymore. I don't remember ever hearing that we were going to slow down our cord production. And if you did, you know, please tell me, because I don't remember that.
Well, I guess we have a difference of maybe opinions on what was said, but that we were gonna primarily try to focus on the campfire wood, because that's what you've been pushing to want us to do the last few years. And we had still taken orders back in March, and so I felt that it was necessary to fill those orders that were taken. People are expecting the wood. And at the time, in March, we didn't know we were going to run out of logs by July.
So, if I'm right?
Please.
So you're not taking any more orders for cordwood?
No, I've shut off all the cordwood customers. I shut off all the fuel assistance customers. We're not selling anything. I finished that commitment of those about 30 cords, and that's it.
Okay. And I guess how many cords did you... So did you fall short on what you could have produced and sold this year to the state parks?
Yes.
Do you have any idea how many cords you fell short?
Well, we're dealing with bags, mostly.
Bags go to cords.
So, cords. Well, yes. But off the top of my head, we were probably 5,000 bags that we sold this year, 5,000 to 6,000. And we could have probably easily sold 10,000, 11,000 if we had the wood all seasoned and ready to go. So that's about the difference that we didn't have for the... But the thing was, is the wood that I sold to the cordwood, because I think I know where you're going with this, was not wood that I saved before July. When I ran out of wood, I ran out of wood, any seasoned wood, period. We got wood in late July, we seasoned that for the cordwood. And the state did not want, he told me to keep the wood and let it season for next year, and then he would start buying it from us again. He didn't want to start buying wood from us again late August. He wanted it to be well seasoned. So there was no wood that I was holding back and not selling, is my point. We got wood in, and then I sold that to fulfill that commitment.
So the wood you got in recent times, you then used that for your cordwood salespeople?
The 30 cords of it, correct. So we got it in late July, we processed it up, let it season out there, and then end of September, 1st of October, we delivered it and sold it.
How do you, I'm not in your business. How do you gauge how much wood you're going to need as the year goes along? It just seems to me that you must have known well ahead of July that you're going to run out of wood.
I knew I was going to be short, but I didn't know when the buyer, or the seller, that we were going to buy more wood, because we had it in the budget to buy more wood. I didn't know when they would be able to provide it. I was hoping we were going to get it at the, like in April, when the budget was finalized. But instead, because wood is hard to get a hold of, we couldn't get it until middle of July, end of July. And that's why we ran out. If I would have gotten it in April, we could have been processing it and letting it season to get us through the season.
Okay.
And I think during this time, this past summer, I know the mills were paying a lot more for hardwood in log length, so it was harder for any firewood dealer to get hardwood at a decent rate. So I know Will tried a couple of his normal vendors, and they would rather sell it to the mill for a higher profit than sell it to us. So that's why I think he was having difficulty obtaining wood, hardwood anyways. We have recently, though, we have an agreement with another gentleman who has been providing us the cordwood. And hopefully, and the market for hardwood in the mills is starting to drop off, so it may be a little more easier to obtain the hardwood logs.
I understand that. I'm trying to go back to, so you had monies to buy log length wood in your budget this year.
Yes.
Okay. You weren't able to secure wood until July.
Correct. Okay. Late July.
Okay. But you knew well ahead of July that you were going to run into an issue and probably not be able to fill your contract with what you had. So going forward, if I look out in the field and I've got, I can relate it to, I'm going to sell X number of eggs in the store every year, and if I don't have that sitting there, I can't sell it. So let's move beyond. You have a cut coming forward this year, and so if you could help me out, what's your 5,000 bags, your 10,000 bags? I'm sure you have a little bit of waste, and I'm sure that the log length has a defined yield out of it typically. So how many cords of wood do you need to fill? What was your expectation? 100, 500 bags? What was your hope for this year that you based your projection on?
For 2015 we're talking about, or
yeah, forward? Yeah, the year we're in right now, we fell short.
So I was hoping to be between 10 to 12,000.
Okay, so 12,000 bags takes ballpark how many cords of wood?
It's 150. I figure about 150 bags per cord of wood. So 12. I think 12 is a little ambitious, but we'll go with that. It would take 80 cords of wood.
Thank you. So if 80 cords of wood is needed, plus or minus, to make your project work. And if I look at the intent to cut the commissioner's file, maybe you could help me with that. And maybe I'm not reading it correctly, but it looks to me like in our next cut, we're looking to take in about 36 cords of wood.
Right, that's the, that's...
36 cords of hardwood.
Hardwood, three loads.
Okay, so how many cords of softwood?
None.
So we're already, so... If the direction of the delegation was that when we buy a wood processor, that we are not going to have to go out and buy other wood because we own a farm of hundreds of acres of wood, and that we're going to be self-sustaining going forward from that time forward, And my understanding is that we fell short of that projection because in our last cut, which must have been a much bigger cut than what we have here, it was more profitable for the county to sell that wood and take that money. How going forward for next year, how do you hope to make up 50 cords of firewood?
Well, we're putting money in the budget to buy it. That's the thought process. I mean, you can only, the land is managed for log, nice log, forest and management plan is for logs to come off. Firewood is a byproduct. So we can't just go strip the land to meet the amount of wood we need for this program. So if you want me to just process what comes off the land, then the machine that we're paying on is just going to sit there. We need to have the logs come in so I can sell it. I need product to be able to sell. And the land that we have here, that's unrealistic for the amount that I'm selling to think that we can get that off this land.
Thank you. That was the point a number of years ago, that the plan that the county had in place was insufficient to handle what the needs of the county are. But we were told repeatedly by commissioner's office that was not the case, and from other people that we would be a sustaining process here. But now, after two cuts, it's become painfully obvious that that's not the case. So now it's a matter of whether, going forward, the delegation then is going to approve purchasing outside product to keep that program alive. I understand it now.
And there's also other types of wood that are coming off that we don't use here, that we're selling.
Well, I understand you have some chipping, and I'll come back to your representative in a second here. I understand that you have, you know, some wood that has no use of, and it's better to be sold for pulp, which is apparently what's happening with some of this. But if we have the availability to, and it's profitable, we're in a downturn this year, but if it's profitable that you can sell softwood, you can sell hardwood, and that it makes sense for you to do that, most all of these wood products, other than what's going to be chipped, seem to me like they probably would work in those two categories.
Correct.
But we're far in going forward, so if we're a sustainable forest, which is what we have, which we want to be, it appears that our yield is going to, you know, come nowhere near close to that. So,
thank you, Mr. Chair. Superintendent Dewitt has come to us again and again and again to explain this, and I know sometimes I need to be reminded also, but I think it would be more effective and more appropriate to ask him to do an orientation and education piece for our subcommittee, for the other delegation members, and for anyone in the public who wants to come, than to keep repeating it in these meetings. And you told me at the beginning of this meeting today that we were here to discuss the year to date, that this is separate, that this is not, but we have a process in place for setting the budget for the next year. And this is not that time. So is it really your intention to see how we're doing this year up to date?
Thank you. It is.
Good.
I have asked on a few occasions for questions on the wood production, and the answers have always come from Will through the administrator and back. I thought it'd be a lot more productive if during this meeting we have the opportunity as a subcommittee to ask a question, because this is going to be a large budget item for next year. So getting a handle on it now, and I can't see a need for, if Will would like to come before and talk about wood production and how we can't sustain our business plan on what it was presented to us as being and what would work, so be it. But I think it's a lot easier for us now at this point to and ask some questions about different programs so that when we're just about into that point of starting up the new cycle, we'll all be on the same page.
So this, what you told me before about the purpose of this meeting is moot now. So we are now going to discuss what we're going to do coming forward in the next year. And then when the budget process comes, you know, in another month or two, we're going to do it again.
I'm not going into next year's budget. I'm trying to understand why we have shortfalls right now.
We're now talking about what we're going to do next year.
Well, perhaps that would be your opinion, and thank you.
Thank you.
If I might, go ahead.
Yes.
Most of the cuts that are done are large cuts, and there's a lot of slash left over. I'm thinking maybe we can get, you know, some of the slash that's done from this cut, and if it's pine, we can utilize that for, you know, for the bagwood, if there's enough slash.
Thank you, and that brings me back to my original statement. What is it that the Department of Corrections, whoever it is, what they're looking for, what's the proposal that we need to fill? Because perhaps, you're correct in what you're saying, perhaps Will has to approach them and ask if that's a product that we can fit in. But that's why I also think it's a lot better to have this discussion now, months ahead of that happening again, than waiting till we're into the heat of a new budget. So, Karen.
Will, what line item did you buy the logs under?
Purchase resale line item, ma'am, which probably is 099, towards the bottom of your 7100-099. Probably be at the bottom, you see it, purchase resale.
Oh, okay. I couldn't find that. Thank you. And?
Go ahead.
Okay, that's fine.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On the revenue side, then, 055 account sale of wood would encompass both cordwood and firewood, and we're at 63% as of the projected revenue as of the end of October. Two related questions: will there be any more sales this year, or is that pretty much the final number? And you talked about a cut in, I think, 2015. Is that correct? There will be a cut before the end of the year, or the cut will be in 2016?
Well, it depends. If it's frozen, then they can do the cut. But if it's not, then they can't. So if it's cold enough in December, maybe. But I anticipate early 2016.
So the other first question was, the 63% as of October 31st with the sale of wood, is that a final number for the year, pretty much?
There's a minor difference of some coming in, but that's the majority of it, yes.
Thank you.
And just to follow up, so that number includes your, what was it, 11 cordwood sales, that's already been delivered and paid for?
Correct, it includes that. We're waiting for one or two more bills to be paid, but other than that, yes, it includes the majority of it.
And I think one of those was mentioned back in July. Bill, the state still needs to $1,312.50. Is that still outstanding, or is that part of what you understand is still waiting to be collected?
No, the state's all paid up.
Okay, so. If the state's all paid up and you paid for your cord, I guess I'm just asking the question, what other revenue do you have coming in from wood?
I have, I believe, one or two more cordwood customers that will be sending their checks into us that were delivered recently.
Okay. And that's tracked, and we usually get paid 30 days, something like that
Correct.
Sort of thing?
Right.
Okay. Okay, so that's cordwood. Hay, my understanding, was a bad year. Is that pretty much why?
Yes, sir.
sorry. Please.
It was my understanding that the farmers were doing quite well with their hay production this year, that there wasn't a shortage of hay, that it was a good year. So why was it not a good year for us?
Well, to be honest, I'm not sure which farmers you're talking to, but a lot of them, when you look at the rain gauge, we had very little rain this year, which in turn grows the grass, and therefore we did not have as much grass grow. Also, we've had a downward slope, and we changed up our fertilization program this year. Instead of doing a spring fertilizer, we did a fall fertilizer. So that combination between very dry and then also the change in fertilizer program resulted in less bales this year, which resulted in less money. We did raise the price on the bales this year, but we still fell short.
So everything, if I could, everything we produced, we sold?
Yes.
Can I ask, it's pretty daunting, the task you have. You have a farm, you have maintenance. Who do you rely on to help you with things like, you talked about a change in fertilization and so forth. Who's helping you with that?
Combination of things. We take soil samples that are sent down to Cooperative Extension. I also work with the Cooperative Extension Educator for recommendations through their resources. And I've also used some input from the commissioners in the past and other local farmers of what they're doing in the area.
Thank you. Have you, I guess being a layman in this, have you seen hay production falling over the last couple, 3 years because of fertilization?
Yes, the last 2 years, so 13 and 14, we noticed a decline that was coming on. The biggest thing is our pH is off, so the fertilizer we're putting in, the grass is not in the right pH to be absorbing it. So that was a main factor that we went after this year to get it back up.
On what we've been buying for fertilizer, has that just been staying steady, or have we been increasing that over the last couple, 3 years?
It's been staying the same. We had one bump that we bumped, I believe, maybe $500 up 3 or 4 years ago. But other than that, we've been maintaining it with that price.
Anyone else questions on hay? So we must have a lot of room in our barns if we're all out of hay then.
No, because we have our equipment in the barns. And then the rest of the space is being filled with campfire wood. Never said I didn't have any. I said this morning that we're currently, as we speak, that we're working on bagging campfire wood. We ran out in July is what I said, but when we got the new wood and got a season, we're currently bagging for next year.
I didn't understand that.
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry.
Other income is produce. How was produce production? What'd you switch up last year to this year?
We actually downsized our garden this year because it was underutilized last year. In the meantime, due to the changeover at the jail, we've taken on kind of a new program with them, and most of the stuff that came out of the jail, out of the garden this year, went into the jail, and they processed it and froze it in vacuum sealed bags, and then we took it over to the nursing home so it was more usable for them. By doing that, it took advantage of a lot more of our products that were produced, even though we had a small garden. Also, we had a bumper crop this year in blueberries. It was just a very good year for all fruits for the most part in New Hampshire. Noticed the apple trees have done really well this year. Blueberries was in the same category.
Okay, so what about tomatoes? I only asked tomatoes because we got that high tunnel out there and it's filled with tomatoes. So,
excuse me, the tomato production, actually that whole 90% of that hoop house out there was kind of, in my opinion, probably underutilized. And the reason being is there were several tomatoes put in there with the Cooperative Extension, who did a really good job in managing them and recording. They were doing experiments in there. But by time, the way she picks them, because of her experiment, she waits till they're, for example, that they're very ripe, because that's when you pick tomatoes. And the contents that we use here, I have to pick them just before ripe for the nursing home, because they're sliced there in the different times that they might be sitting in there for a few days, etc. So by the time we got some of those, they weren't able to be used as well for tomatoes. I know Rob was working on making tomato paste or sauces with some of those. But the main thing was, it was her experiment going on this year, and that was part of the deal for the grant of the hoop house. And it's going to be very beneficial, not necessarily, we didn't necessarily benefit from it, but local farmers in the county, this information is all being distributed to them, which varieties grew the best under these conditions and such. And she's publishing that for all of the local farmers in Carroll County. So it didn't necessarily benefit us to full production that we could possibly do. But it was beneficial to the people in the county, I believe.
That's good. The our commitment for that program, they supplied us with a tunnel, and then it becomes ours on hoop. I guess hoop is a better description for your buildings. And we were to provide them the space, and or apparently this, what you referred to as an experiment on tomato production. Are we done with their commitment? Is that our building at this point?
I would say yes, that it is our building. There was an understanding of it that they would be able to do different experiments in there at certain times. Doesn't mean that she's going to do it every year, but in the spirit of cooperating, that was kind of the intent when it went up, is that when there was different experiments to be done, that some space would be available for her.
Okay. Well, I'll take that discussion up with the commissioners. But when we accepted that grant, my understanding as a delegation member was that we were provided that building, and that we would be in agreement with them for a year's time for things that need to be done. Then afterwards, the building became ours. So I guess looking forward to next year, you must have some idea of how much space, if there needs to be space allotted for that sort of thing, and how do you see that being a benefit to you next year for vegetable production or whatever, a place to put tractors. I don't know. I'm just wondering. You're going into your next season, your next budget. Is that under your consideration?
Currently, well, first off, equipment and tractors would not fit in that building. But
I could
at
get
this,
in there.
Well, sure, if we cut the walls down. But at this point, there's no plans with the Cooperative Extension as of today that I'm aware of for next year. So at that point, that whole building would be available for our production.
Okay, fine. That would be great. That would be absolutely great. So when this bumper crop of vegetables we had that went through the prison, long term, I'm sure.
Corrections.
Did corrections buy that product from you?
No, the nursing home did.
Okay, so the nursing home apparently bought a much greater abundance this year than they did the year previous?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
And that was because of the jail?
Correct.
So may I add to that?
Yeah.
I believe it was not only that, but it was a spirit of cooperation between the three departments, and it was the department heads getting together and looking at how could we improve this and ways of working together better. So it was a group effort.
No,
a change in paradigm for the county.
No, I wasn't arguing that. I just, because one of the problems that we had faced in the past is that the nursing home could not handle all of the fresh vegetables that were coming in. And so they were only buying what they needed.
understand, and I'm just adding to that, saying that that was not the only factor.
Very fine, and so I'm glad to see that that occurred.
Good.
But we didn't know about it, or I didn't know about it, so, you know, I guess it's kept secret.
I don't think so, Madam Chair.
Well, I guess we should hang around here more often than we'll know that. Okay, the, oh, Glenn, please.
Thank you. With the abundant vegetable production this year, even with the downsizing, there was, you mentioned apples, blueberries, for instance, excess that was sold to individuals and not to other county departments. Is that correct?
There were some private sales that were sold. There was minor amount of wholesales to local food stands that we have helped, and always in the past, help enhance their business by providing with the product they don't have. And then probably 90% of it was all packaged at the jail for the nursing home.
And when you do that, then the county gets monies back from providing that product for them, or is that for federal food programs?
So yes, to answer your question, we get cash when we take to those places.
The year previous, I'd read in some of my minutes that a lot of the produce, that we had provided a lot of produce for federal programs and other things. Was that still, or are we working more towards the profit end at this point and having to take excess, give excess away?
I'm not sure what you mean by federal programs, because I'm not involved in any federal programs.
Well, I just assumed we were giving it to food banks and things like that.
If that's what you consider a federal program, then yes, we have. And this year we also donated quite a bit to local food pantries also. A lot of those unusable tomatoes, for example, that weren't used for our facility here, but were able to be donated. We had excess cucumbers, which are a product that you cannot freeze over at the jail. So those were provided to a lot of the food banks also. Pretty much anything that was freezable was frozen here. And there was very couple things, mostly tomatoes and cucumbers that were donated.
Okay. Anything else on income at this point? Okay. Let's talk about, I sit on the nursing home subcommittee, and we've had conversations a couple times over there about last winter and how we maintain our roads and sidewalks and so forth over there, parking structures for the employees. And it appeared to be probably not the highest level of satisfaction. A number of years ago, I've got a memo here from 2011, the county entertained snow removal to go to an outside source to provide that for you. And I know recently the commissioners took up our request at a meeting, and a majority of the commissioners felt that what they were doing was what they wanted to continue to do, but I also heard, saw, and was told that if the subcommittee wanted to investigate that further, then the delegation wanted to investigate that further, then perhaps that could be their charge. So I'd like to discuss that for a moment. In 2011, when we'd sent out I don't know that I have it all here with me, but I'm sure we can have it pulled out. It was an email or fax that was sent to me on 2/25/2011 from Kathy Gary. And the very first page, very first page of that proposal was that there's a zero tolerance for snow and ice in the walkways and parking lots. Emergency personnel need to be able to access all buildings at all times at every shift change for each department. The walkways and parking lots should be ready. I mean, you wear many hats, and my question has been, when we went out to bid, was that a realistic standard, and is that the standard that you and your department abide by?
I believe it's a realistic standard to have a contractor come in here. We do the best we can with the money and the equipment that we're given. There are times when there are black and white situations, there's times when there's gray situations depending on the weather, and we do the best we can. But in my experience, if you're going to have a contractor come in here and they're going to bid on something, they need to have it in black and white what you want. That is what that was put together, is to be black and white with no questions. Do we try to obtain that as best we can? Yes. Do we use 100% salt here? No. We use salt and sand, primarily 95% sand. That's what our budget has provided us, and we do the best we can with that. So can I meet those standards every time, every storm? No, I'm not going to tell you that I can, but I do. We do the best that we can with what we have. We just expect if a contractor is going to come in that we give them black and white parameters that this is what we want to have done.
Thank you. But I guess my question was, do you abide by the zero tolerance for snow and ice on walkways and parking lots, which is the number one? My question is that when we went out to bid and when we go out to bid the next time, do you feel that zero tolerance for snow and ice on walkways and parking lots is the necessity, is the most important overdriving, is the first thing on here?
Someone else is coming on this facility and to do that job, then yes, I believe that is. Seems to be generally the normal standard when we look at other businesses, the courthouse, those places that bring in contractors, that's generally a normal standard. So if we were to do that, then I would believe that would be in the best interest for the county.
Sounds good, but it's not a policy that we follow.
No, there's...
I understand. If I go down through here, and I'll come back to you, Representative. When I go down through here and I look at the administration building, the jail, and I know there's another page missing here. I'm sure there's another building, old nursing home. Snow has to be removed for zero tolerance. Got 5 shift changes. And I would assume, again, that this is something that would be nice to do, but probably not something we ourselves are doing.
Was that a question, sir?
Yes.
Well, if you're going to keep harping on zero tolerance,
I'm here all the
shifts, so yes, it's all open up for all the shifts.
But it's not a standard we're following as we expect someone else to follow. I guess my point is that if this is what's really needed, this zero tolerance for snow and ice, if this is what was really needed, and this costs us more money to do, and this will reduce on the possibility of injury or so forth, which we and other people have all during winter, then we should either be abiding by it or then come up with the funds to do that. And again, here we are coming into a new budget. Your wells are where? Your primary wells for the complex and for... You're the largest water supplier in the town. Where are our wells at?
We're not the largest water supplier, but our wells are up on the hill.
Up on the hill, but not down in this area. Not within 3,000, 5,000 feet of this area.
I don't believe that.
So... So explain to me why when we have severe events, because I know when you have your sand and salt must be undercover, I imagine, or do you buy it as you need it?
No, it's un- We have it undercover, but we cannot buy enough for the whole season. So we do have every about a month, month and a half, depending on how many storms and how severe the weather is, we have to replenish it. But we usually have enough for, you know, on average 3 to 4 weeks in storage.
Okay. And when you do that, you buy tractor trailer loads? Is that how you buy?
There's a dump truck that comes in. I believe it's 14 to 16 yards, something like that. And we'll get, we can fit about three of those into our salt sand shed. We dump it outside, we move it in, and mix salt by hand into the shed.
Okay. Is there some reason why you can't buy more salt or use more salt? What's the philosophy of not using salt? Or are you considering using brine as some of the contractors are going to?
That was, as was brought up here a few weeks ago, Ken had mentioned that. The two problems that I've brought to the attention about this issue is, one, infrastructure. We don't have enough. I only have one bay for salt and sand right now. So if we want to go to more salt or 100% salt, at times in the wintertime it can be hard to buy. So we need to purchase a whole year's worth at a time and have a facility to store it in. Right now that facility we have would not hold a whole year's worth. That's the first issue. I need the proper infrastructure to store it. Second issue is budgetary. You know, I have about $5,000 in there that is for salt and sand mix. I'm not an expert, so don't quote me, but I'm guessing it's between twice to three times the amount from what I've been told by contractors that you need to buy salt, that amount, same amount of salt versus sand. So it's been the practice that the commissions have directed me to stick with the salt and sand that we currently do, because it budgetary is better than three times that amount for the salt. Doesn't mean we couldn't switch. If that's the way the delegation wants to go and Ken directs me to do that, then I'm more than willing to do it. I'm just telling you this is what we have, and this is how we do with what we have.
Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied with how you're able to take care of your facilities with what it is you have and how you've done it?
I would like, most of the time, yes. But there's times when it gets real cold in the middle of wintertime. This is a 24-hour-7 operation, so that means people are coming and going, and they pack the snow. You know, you get an inch of snow. It's not enough to plow yet, but they're packing it, driving in here. And then when it doesn't get warm enough, that stuff starts to harden on the pavement. When it finally warms up after 2 or 3 weeks sometimes, we can get out there and actually remove that. It would be nice to have something in place to prevent that from happening. And if a pure salt would do that, it would be great to have that, because I am not satisfied with that. Currently what we have, we have to be, we have to live with it.
When you look over to the courthouse, you're out there driving around and so forth.
Sure.
Did you see over the course of the winter that their roads are piled up with snow and ice and packing coming and going, or was their parking areas pretty much blacktop? Which is the way I normally saw it.
Yes, you're correct. Their parking lot is normally blacktop. A, they use 100% salt over there. B, they're not a 24-hour facility. When the people leave at 5, 6 o'clock in the evening, they don't return over there until 7, 8 o'clock in the morning. So when I'm here at 3 in the morning, about 3:30 or so, Brooks's guys show up over there and they start plowing. All night they've had nobody driving on that, not packing it. It's easier to get it up along with that salt. But again, we have shift change in between, sometimes two shift changes between that amount of time when they have nobody over there.
I understand. I plowed commercial properties 30 plus years. Plowed home subdivisions, you know, coming and going is more difficult. But what gets me back to that, and I'll get off this. Anyone else wants to discuss this further? If we go out and we say we want a zero tolerance for snow and ice is our standard, and we ask that for a bid, then I think it's highly misleading to then come back and say the reason we're not considering contracts from anybody else is because they're so much higher a cost than what it is we're providing. And I question whether what we've asked for and what we're providing are the same. So I think we'll mull around as a delegation going forward, perhaps another bid going forward, but I really want to make note here that what we ask people to abide by and what we provide are two entirely different things. Chicken and eggs, however you want to say it, but to come back here and for the commissioners to say that, you know, it's absolutely ridiculous, and we're saving money. They could possibly be saving money, because they're not giving you the products you need to take care of your roads.
I hardly know where to begin. There's so much, but because so much time has elapsed.
Take it a step at a time.
Okay, first off, I was going to ask for a copy of what the document you were referring to,
sure,
so that we could have the benefit of that as well. I won't take the time now, but I will ask you to attach that to the yeah. minutes of today's meeting. I don't know what it says in there, but I don't think it says having somebody on the premises 24 hours, 24/7. I also don't know why you think that this subcommittee should be writing the RFP when that is the job of the commissioners.
Commissioner said that we should do that if we wanted to.
Okay, fine. I also think that it certainly appears that we are questioning the quality of the work done by our department here. And I don't believe that that is the role of this subcommittee. I believe it's the role of the commissioners to supervise and evaluate the staff. So I just suggest that we be a little bit more mindful of that and a little bit more respectful of our employees.
I concur with what you said. I'm bringing up questions that on the quality of care. I have absolutely nothing but respect for the, I believe it's all gentlemen that are working presently and taking care of the winter maintenance. And I know for myself how overwhelming it can be. But there were shortcomings in the past winter that other departments don't want to see happen again. And again, winter's coming. And this, I feel it's perfectly appropriate. If the problem that the crew was happening was that they didn't have the right product to do their job properly, safely for the people, then that needs to be addressed now. And before my conversation that this committee's having right now, I really haven't heard or seen too much change. And from the commissioner's office, and perhaps I'm not privy to that, but it has come up in one of my subcommittee meetings, and the majority of our employees come from that facility, the difficulty they were having, and I think it's more than appropriate to talk about that. And I think it's more than appropriate to talk about this subject, because the commissioners did say if we wanted to move forward with an RFP, then maybe we should.
I might just suggest that we could find a less confrontational tone with which to move forward and affect positive change.
I'll accept that from you.
And I really look forward to hearing you make a proposal in the next budget hearing to provide more adequate funding for what we need to accomplish the job.
That or another contract, yes.
That is a responsibility.
Of the commissioners?
Mm-hmm. Not our responsibility.
Excuse me, it's not our responsibility to set the budget?
That's not what you said.
Okay, so, but what we do as a delegation is to decide what
if it is
each
not,
line
me.
Item will include.
Yeah. If it's not in the budget, okay, if the commissioners decide that they don't want the standard of care for snow removal, and it's not in the budget, and it's not added to the budget, or it's not said, if we were to meet this, this is how much it would cost. Okay, if they don't do that, then it's not the delegation's responsibility to tell them how to manage the property. What they have said by doing this, and what Will just said, is that the commissioners in the past are happy with how he's doing it, even though the people that work here in other departments are not necessarily happy. But the commissioners have never come to, at least in the 6-7 years that I've been here, have never come to the delegation and said ABC.
So we routinely add money or subtract money from budget categories routinely. So we certainly can do that, and that certainly is our responsibility.
But it's not our responsibility if we don't know how much it costs. Okay?
Oh, really?
If I add $3 to the budget and say that's going to solve the problem, okay, we know that's not.
I'm sorry, we would just routinely add things without having figures or subtract without figures.
Perhaps you do that in your subcommittee.
No, we do that in the full delegation.
Well, that's a different.
I'll come back to you.
Okay, I need to.
We're ready to wrap.
I just have a comment and I have a question. One is, we have over 300 people, 300 employees, not everyone's going to be satisfied with whatever you do. And no matter what county you work at, no one appreciates the snow removal aspect of it. Either they come in improper footwear, or they're rushing and not watching where they're going. Again, not everyone's going to agree and not everyone's happy. But I'm sure, the staff here does the best that they can. Two, why are we even talking about bids for snow removal when we have our own snow removal personnel?
We had asked back in 2011 if it made sense to consider going outside service so that the department could concentrate on other things during that time of year. And one of our things over at the nursing home is a number is routinely plugged in over there for summer maintenance and winter maintenance. And when we ask on the nursing home subcommittee, how is that number arrived at? No one seems to know how that number's arrived at. In the past, it's always been a number plucked and added over there. When we asked those questions again last year over there, because all the nursing home needs maintained is really just the area around them, summer-wise. And wintertime, they have a need for their roads and so forth. So they, how do they get a true picture of what their costs really are? And so we'd asked again that, and believe me, no one's ever hated more than the guy that drives the plow, that pushes snow into your driveway. Nobody. You just know that when you go out there. I'm not saying that, it was scattered comments. It was questions about how snow is being removed and the condition out there and concerns of elderly people coming and going. So we had asked again to the commissioners out of that subcommittee if the commissioners would go out to bid on winter and summer maintenance over there so we could start contributing a real number to that. They decided a couple weeks ago, I think it was before that, that they were not going to do that. But I believe it was Commissioner Babson or one of the other commissioners that came out and said, we're not going to do that. If the delegation wants to do that, then they can have that. That's why I brought up the conversation. That's why I brought up the 2011 where we went out to bid and we only had two people respond. But I said then, and I say now after I look at it again, if you put an unrealistic proposal out there, you're going to get an unrealistic price. If that is not the standard you need maintained over there, then I'm sure we could get other bids if we did it this time of year or next year ahead of time so that we could then judge, does it make sense for us to have our people on call 24 hours to take care of snow removal over there, where if that was turned over to a private concern, perhaps we could be doing other things that they don't have time for the rest of the year. Winter's typically the time that you catch up on all the maintenance and everything else you need to be done. Commissioner.
Thank you. I'm sorry that Representative Umberger left. She just made the statement that we'd never asked for any increase. I'd like to remind her that you cut almost $200,000 or $300,000 out of sand and salt last year in the budget we put in, proposing to increase it so Will would have more salt. To say that we haven't done anything is another ridiculous statement. Thank you.
Appreciate your comments. Representative.
Thank you. Just noticing that as of the end of October, we had almost a third left in the sand and salt line item. And I was just, how does that position us for the rest of the year and maybe getting ready for 2016?
The hope is, I'm assuming that's directed to me, sir?
Yes, thank you.
The hope is, I'm just trying to look on your budget to just to make sure I'm giving you a proper answer here. Yes, so we still have to get in. Our facility is probably only has about a third. Our building only has about a third of the salt and sand that it can hold. So in the next week to 2 weeks here, the plan is to fill that building, and hopefully that, if the weather cooperates, will be enough to get us through to January 1st, to where we would start on the next year's budget.
So the 1,600 and change left in the budget currently will provide us sand salt through the rest of the year, but not for 2016.
Correct.
If the mix was changed, would there be any different in terms of expenditures for the rest of the year? Would you have, if there was a higher mix of salt in that you obtained in the next few weeks, would that $1,600 be sufficient?
To be honest, I'd have to get back with you because I haven't researched that option.
Thank you. And looking through our budget here, and just briefly looking at our budget before, when the commissioner spoke of slashing money from funds, it's again looking at what was expended the year before, monies weren't expended the year before, and the cut was taken from there for trying to get to a truer representation of how much money is really needed in each department to carry out that department's business. So with all the other items that were overspent over the past years, I would think it would allow the superintendent at this point then to come back and discuss that realistically. But to say that we as the delegation took salt and sand away from a building or people is short-sighted.
Did you cut the budget?
We cut every budget.
And you don't pay for sand and salt, so if you cut the budget, it only goes to stand that we couldn't buy salt and sand. So I just have to say yes, you cut the budget.
So I thank you for, and I'll end here, but we still have $1,700 sitting in that budget. And like any other winter, State of New Hampshire projects out we're going to spend $10 million to maintain our roads for salt and sand. And we get through the first 4 months last year, and it looked like we were going to have a shortfall. They came back and requested more money, and more money was brought forward. We've had no requests that we were shortfalled here and had to get more money. Pretty simple.
I do recall, though, that we did go back and ask every department to make further cuts. Just a note.
I think that's what our practice has always been. And the county, to this point, has never had a problem finding money, whether it was authorized or not, to spend to handle their appropriations.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we've had a very productive day. I think we have some information going forward, and I want to thank all those for being present today.
And one more item before we close.
Yes.
May I just request that when you call the next meeting that you send out an agenda ahead of time so that we'll know what the purpose is? Thank you.
For a work session, I'd be happy to.
Yes, please, for any meeting.
Thank you. Thank you all.